8:55 Eastern Time. And Columbia and its affiliated stations bring you Elmer Davis and the news.
The war on the West Front was rained out today, and for the first time in this war, and perhaps the last, the French and German communiqués were in complete agreement. They described the situation as calm. German planes appeared four times off the east coast of Scotland, but were driven off with no casualties on either side, and no bombs dropped. Two of the flights came over the Firth of Forth, apparently reconnoitering the great naval base at Rosyth, which was attacked on Monday. The British evidently expect more attacks there, for our London correspondent, Mr. Morrow, reported earlier this evening that they are evacuating more schoolchildren from the vicinity of Rosyth and Edinburgh. But while the battlefronts are calm, the propagandists are at it hot and heavy. The German official news bureau this evening picked up the affidavit submitted to the State Department on Tuesday by Gustav H. Anderson of Evanston, Illinois, a passenger on the Athenia, who said that the Athenia carried as cargo guns to be mounted in the defenses of Quebec and Halifax, a statement that the owners of the ship have denounced as tommy rot. The German version of Anderson's story added that the ship was also carrying concrete gun bases to be mounted at Montreal. Anderson also said, and the British agree on this, that the Athenia stayed afloat for hours after the explosion and was eventually sunk by shells from British destroyers, which the British say was done to remove the hulk as a menace to navigation. But the Germans maintain that this proves that the explosion was internal and add that it is now conclusively proved that the Athenia was sunk by order of Winston Churchill and that he is a pathological liar if he denies it. But why should Churchill want to sink a ship carrying coast defense guns to Canada? The logic of this is as hard to follow as the reasons why concrete construction should be shipped across the Atlantic. The British War Office denounced as flimsy and mendacious the German story that England had supplied poison gas to Poland and said that the Germans were preparing an alibi for using poison gas themselves, something which all the great European powers renounced in 1925. American correspondents with the German army in Poland have reported that they saw evidence that gas was used, but none that the British had supplied it. Finland's reply to Russia will be given on Monday, and dispatches from Helsinki tonight indicate that the Finns will adopt a firm stand calling for an immediate settlement. That is the language used. As a mere matter of relative force, of course, Finland cannot demand an immediate settlement. And that phrase has been taken as suggesting that perhaps the question is already virtually settled, presumably on terms that the Finns could accept as not compromising their independence. But so far, that is only speculation. The most encouraging sign is that the Russians don't seem to be in much of a hurry. But the Moscow newspaper Pravda today quoted Stalin, who is rarely quoted, as saying in connection with the recent Russian international maneuvers that their success strengthens our faith in our power and mobilizes us for a new struggle and new victories of communism. Franz von Papen, the German ambassador to Turkey, came home today to make his report on the signing of the Turkish treaty with England and France. A Berlin report says that Hitler will also call home his ambassadors from Italy and Russia to talk over with them what Germany can do in the way of retaliatory measures. The Germans seem to have taken the signature of this treaty pretty hard, with more annoyance than its present practical significance seems to justify. But while the circumstances which would bring the treaty into operation seem hardly likely to arise just at present, it has a considerable significance from the point of view of prestige. It proves that in spite of the lack of any Allied successes in the war so far, the Turks still think that it is worthwhile to stand by England and France. The German reaction is one of several symptoms of a nervousness which is apparent in Berlin and is quite unjustified by the military situation. President Roosevelt said today that the limits of what we regard as American territorial waters are flexible, depending on particular cases. Submarines are barred only from the old three-mile limit, but he said that in general it would be silly to establish a definite three-mile limit or 20-mile limit or 1,000-mile limit. In the Senate, Mr. Brown of Michigan called Colonel Lindbergh's recent speech a gratuitous insult to Canada and said that our purpose in forbidding a foreign invasion of Canada is to protect not Canada but ourselves. Hiram Johnson denounced as an idiotic assumption the theory that if the Allies are beaten, Germany will attack us next. After a European war, he said, all combatants would be exhausted, and if Hitler conquered Europe and tried to move on America, he would leave rebellion behind him everywhere. The British labor leaders, Major Attlee and Arthur Greenwood, today expressed their regret that the government had decided to postpone the organization of India as a dominion till the end of the war. That sentiment is felt more strongly in India.
This is the Columbia Broadcasting System.